Hi friends, I'm Srishti Jain and today we are going to do another set of 5 questions of finance. If you like my video, then do subscribe to our channel for more regular updates. I'll be making more videos on finance for you. Now, without wasting any time, let's move to the first question for today. The first question says, which among the following categories is not included in category 1 of FPI? So you have to tell me that which of these is not included in it. So let's move to the next slide to have a look on category 1 and category 2 of FPI. And if you are following my series regularly, then you must know that in previous video, I have talked about category 1 FPI and category 2 FPI. So this is a kind of a revision question for you. And I hope that you'll be able to answer this question if you have followed the previous video sincerely. And for those who are new, welcome all. We'll be doing category 1 and category 2 again in brief. So category 1 FPI includes government and government related investors, pension funds and university funds, appropriately regulated entities such as insurance or banks, AMC, etc., and entities from FATF member countries. FATF is Financial Action Task Force member countries. Now we have category 2 FPI, and these are the entities which are included in the category 2 of FPI. So category 1 and category 2 are based upon the level of risk, and earlier there were 3 categories of FPI which recently have been slashed to 2 categories. So category 1 belongs to the low risk. As you can see that these are the ones which includes government and entities like foreign central banks or sovereign wealth funds or entities from FATF member countries. So based on this classification, let's answer the question. So pension funds, university funds and entities from FATF member countries form a part of category 1 of FPI. Family offices is the correct answer, which comes under category 2 of FPI. Now moving on to the next question for today. The next question is, dividend policies based on relevance and irrelevance are given by many theorists. One such theorist gave a model where it suggests bird in the hand argument. It can also be referred to as. So before answering the question, we must know that what is this bird in hand argument and which theorists give this in order to have the correct answer. So let's see it in detail in the next slide. So guys, dividend policies have been given by many theorists, and those dividend policies are classified on the basis that is dividend relevant or is it irrelevant. So based on the relevance and irrelevance, dividend policies have been classified. So you all must heard Gordon's model. So Gordon gave the bird in the hand argument, and he proposed a model suggesting that the dividend policy is relevant and can affect the value of the share and that of the firm. So what does this model say? That there is a growth rate of the firm which can be calculated as BR. Now what BR is? B means the retention ratio, whereas R is the rate of return. And what is retention ratio? If you have a doubt, then if a company has some funds and it distributes 40% of it as dividend, then 0.6 will be your retention ratio. So now let's discuss that what bird in the hand argument means. It means that the dividend policy is relevant as the investors prefer to have current dividends as against the future uncertain capital gains. Now this is a human psychology. Even you would want to have present returns and gains than to have future uncertain gains. So this is what bird in the hand argument means. And the formula for Gordon's model is, that is, you can find the market price of the equity share by earnings 1 minus B. Now what is 1 minus B? 1 minus the retention ratio, which will come out to be the payout ratio. And then we have KE, that is the cost of equity share capital, minus your BR. And as we have discussed, BR is equals to G, that is the growth rate. So this is what Gordon's model formula is. And as it assumes that there is G and there is a constant growth in the firm. So now let's move back to the question to answer it. So the answer to this question is, Option B, that is constant growth model of equity valuation. Now moving on to the next question for today. Now consider the following statements with respect to Indian depository receipts and choose the correct one. So I hope that you all know what Indian depository receipts is, because while discussing the depository receipts concept with you, I have discussed the three types of depository receipts, that is ADR, GDR and IDR. If we have to summarize it and to recall it, then see, what IDR is? It is an instrument denominated in Indian rupees in the form of a depository receipt created by domestic depository against the underlying equity of issuing company to enable the foreign companies to raise funds from the Indian security markets. So what IDR is? Basically, a foreign firm raises the funds from the Indian security markets by issuing Indian depository receipts. So now let's read the statements. IDR is an instrument denominated in Indian rupees in the form of depository receipt, which is true. A foreign company cannot access Indian securities market for raising funds through issue of IDRs. This is not correct, because a foreign company, when raises the funds from Indian securities market, it can issue IDRs for raising those funds. The third is that IDRs can be purchased by any person who is resident in India as defined under FEMA. So this is also true. So the correct answer is option C, which is 1 and 3. So there's a homework for you guys. Do search and tell me that what external commercial borrowings are and how is it different from IDR. Now moving on to the next question for today. The question says, when the government securities are issued through the process of auction, the rate of interest, that is the coupon rate, gets fixed through a market-based price discovery process. Which among the following statements is not true with respect to the method of auctions? So before reading on to the option, let's see that what are the keywords used in it, and then we'll understand those keywords in the next slide. First is uniform pricing, then we have multiple price auction, then we have price based auction and the competitive bidding. Now let's understand this in the next slide, and I'll be going slow because this is one of the important concepts in finance and you must know that how it works. So now we are going to understand what yield-based auction, price-based auction, multiple price, uniform price and competitive bidding are. So prior to the introduction of auctions as a method of issuance, the interest rates were administratively fixed by the government. With the introduction of auctions, the rate of interest gets fixed through a market-based price discovery process. So an auction may be either price-based or it can either be yield-based. So first, let's understand that what yield-based method is. So it is generally conducted with a new government security which has to be issued. So investors bid in the yield returns, and then the bids are arranged in the ascending order and the cutoff yield is arrived at the yield corresponding to the notified amount of the auction. So example here is, so if a government wants to raise 1000 crore rupees, that is, this is the notified amount, and there are suppose 8 bidders here. Everyone is bidding the yield. Some say it to be 8.19%, some say it to be 8.20%, and so on. And we have to arrange this in the ascending order. Then we have the amount of bid. So suppose the first person says that he is ready to give 300 crore, the next says 200 crore, and some say to 250 crore, and so on. Then we find out the cumulative amount of these amounts. So suppose at fifth bidder, 1000 crore has been matched with the notified amount, and this bidder has bid the yield of 8.22%. So this comes out to be the cutoff yield and therefore the coupon rate, and the bidders beyond the fifth bidder are rejected. Only these bidders will be considered. So here the yield is the bidding point. Whereas in the price based auction, what happens is, suppose again there are 8 bidders. So price of the bid is there. Some say it to be 100.19, and note that this is in the descending order. Some say it to be 100.14, 100.13, and so on. And similarly, the amount of bid is calculated and the cumulative amount is calculated. So suppose again on the fifth bidder, 1000 crore is matched. So the bidder beyond this fifth bidder, where the notified amount is matched, they are rejected. Now see, if a government wants to raise money through government securities, so it has to give out the yield and people will purchase the government securities. So here, suppose if 100 is said to be the cutoff price, then the people willing to give more than 100 are considered and less than 100 are not considered, which is beneficial for the government or the issuer. The next is yield based. So here the government, as I have told you, have to give the yield on the securities that the people are purchasing. So as we have already seen that here ascending order is followed. So 6th, 7th, 8th bidders are rejected because they are demanding the yields more than the cutoff yield, and therefore these bidders are considered. Now in these concepts, let us understand what uniform price basis and multiple price basis is. So if the government chooses this 8.22% yield and it chooses to give this yield to every investor, every bidder from 1 to 5, even though they have bid a lesser required rate of return, this is the uniform price. But if the government chooses to give the bid yield to the investor as they have made the bid, then that is the multiple price basis. We can also say it as different investors and different yields. Say suppose to one they will give 8.19%, to second bidder the government will give 8.20% till the fifth bidder. So now can you make the analysis that multiple price will be cheaper than the uniform price basis, because in the uniform price to every investor the government is giving 8.22%, whereas in the multiple price basis the government is giving a lesser required rate of return, a lesser yield to the bidder. Now what competitive bidding is? In a competitive bidding, an investor bids at a specific price or yield and is allotted securities if the price or the yield quoted is within the cutoff price or the yield. Now moving back to the question, after understanding this, the first option says uniform pricing option will cost less to the issuer than the multiple price option, which is not correct. Second is a price based auction is conducted when the government of India reissues the securities which have already been issued earlier. So this is correct. A price based auction is conducted when Government of India reissues the securities, whereas in case of new issues, generally yield based auction is preferred by the government. The third is that uniform pricing will cost more to the issuer than the multiple price auction, as we have seen it. So this is correct. And the last one is, in a competitive bidding, an investor bids at a specific price, yield and is allotted securities if the price or yield is quoted within the cutoff price or yield. So option A is incorrect, because uniform pricing option will cost more to the issuer than the multiple price auction. Now I hope that you have understood the yield based and the price based auctions and their working as well. Now moving on to the last question for today. Dividends can be declared in a variety of ways based upon the short term and the long term targets of an enterprise. So different dividend payout policies exist today and a company can follow any of them to enhance the shareholder returns. With respect to the above statement, stability of dividend policy means that same amount of dividend be paid every year, dividends be paid regularly 2-3 times in a year, extra dividend be paid every year, or there need not be much variation in the dividend payment over the years. So the answer is option D, because stability of dividend means that without much variation, the dividend payout should be there to the investors. Now let's understand what are the different dividend policies there in the next slide. So first is the constant DP ratio. It says that a firm may have a policy of distributing a fixed percentage of earnings as dividend to its shareholders. So suppose a company decides to give 10% of its earnings as dividend to its shareholders. So with the fluctuation in earnings, there will be a fluctuation in dividends as well. So if we see its graph, then the EPS and DPS here on the y-axis and years here. So with EPS, that is the earnings fluctuating, the dividends will also fluctuate per share in tandem with this. The second is steady dividend per share. So here what happens is a steady and a fixed dividend per share to the shareholders is given irrespective of the earnings. However, here the earnings may fluctuate from year to year, and so the firm has to be careful in setting the dividend amount at a reasonable level. And the dividend per share once decided is maintained over few years. So its graph will be like earnings will be fluctuating through the years and the DPS will be somewhat like this. Then we have the steady dividends plus extra. So here steady dividends is given plus some extra whenever supported by the earnings of the company. So this extra amount is considered as bonus paid to the shareholders as a result of usually good year for the firm. So with this, we have completed 5 questions of finance for today. And do not forget to answer the question that I have asked, that is the difference between ECB and IDRs. I hope that you have liked the video. Do subscribe to our channel for more regular updates. Thank you for watching the video.